cause other than vascular origin. But for practical purposes, what we should remember is sudden onset neurological deficit. Sudden onset neurological deficit presumed to be of vascular origin. This definition should be remembered by everyone. So coming to epidemiology, stroke is a common problem, and as per latest WHO data, 1 in 6 person is going to have stroke in their lifetime, and stroke is now second leading cause of death and disability worldwide. In India, every year around 1.7 million new stroke cases occur, and 3 strokes occur per second in India. And 1 in 4 person of stroke, 1 in 4 person who are presenting with stroke are under the age of 65. These are some risk factors of ischemic stroke, and risk factors are same as for cardiovascular diseases. Risk factors are divided into 2 categories, non-modifiable and modifiable. Among non-modifiable risk factors are age, sex, race, genetics, and family history. Modifiable risk factors are hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol, high fibrinogen level, hyperhomocysteinemia, low folate level, underlying cardiac disease, pre-existing history of TIA or stroke. Then coming to clinical features. We all know that all the body functions are controlled by brain, and each function of body is controlled by a specific area of the brain. Like vision is controlled by the visual cortex, hearing is controlled by the lateral auditory cortex lying in the temporal lobe, power is controlled by the motor area in the frontal lobe. So symptoms of strokes depend upon which area of brain is getting affected by the pathological process. So whenever there is some impairment in the blood supply of the brain, patient may have different type of symptoms, and this depends upon which area of the brain is getting affected. Patient may have numbness or weakness on one side of body or both side of body. Patient may present with loss of consciousness. Patient may have sudden onset loss of vision. Patient may have speech disturbance, language disturbance. Patient may have problem in the balance, confusion, difficulty in swallowing, or facial asymmetry. There are some other symptoms with which patient may present. Sometimes patient may present with sudden onset severe headache, neck pain, recurrent vomitings. And to remember, 85% of ischemic stroke patients have hemiparesis, one-sided weakness. And this is a common mnemonic which we all should remember to identify stroke case. This is B fast, B for balance, E for eyes, F for face, A for arm, S for speech, and T for time. If a patient is presenting with sudden onset disturbance in balance, sudden onset loss of vision, facial deviation, speech disturbance, or numbness or weakness in one arm, in these cases, we should suspect stroke. Patient may have one or more of these symptoms. Then coming to classification of stroke, stroke is divided into 2 categories, arterial strokes and venous stroke. Majority of strokes, almost 90% strokes are arterial, and less than 1% are venous stroke. Arterial strokes are again divided into 2 categories, ischemic stroke and hemorrhagic stroke. Ischemic strokes constitute 85%, and remaining 10 to 15% are hemorrhagic stroke. Whenever a patient present with sudden onset focal neurological disturbance, we suspect the patient might be having stroke. But there is possibility of both, that patient might be having ischemic stroke or hemorrhagic stroke. So there are certain clue which suggests us towards hemorrhagic stroke. What are those clues? If a patient is having headache, recurrent vomitings, seizure at onset, or worsening of symptoms from the onset, we may think that possibility of hemorrhage is more than ischemic stroke. There are some other clinical clues which more favor towards hemorrhagic stroke, like if patient is using anticoagulants, patient is suffering from some coagulopathy, advanced liver disease, elderly patient with dementia, or patient is a known case of brain tumor or having some history of aneurysm. In those scenarios, we should keep the possibility of hemorrhagic stroke over ischemic stroke. There are certain clinical clues of ischemic stroke. If a patient is having cardiovascular risk factor like smoking, hypertension, high cholesterol level, diabetes, फैमिली हिस्ट्री ऑफ स्ट्रोक, एट्रियल फिब्रिलेशन, पेशेंट इज अ नोन केस ऑफ कार्डियोमायोपैथी, वॉल्वुलर हार्ट डिजीज एंड दिस टाइप ऑफ पेशेंट इफ प्रेजेंटिंग विद सडन ऑनसेट फोकल न्यूरोलॉजिकल डेफिसिट वी शुड कीप द पॉसिबिलिटी ऑफ इस्केमिक स्ट्रोक ओवर हेमरेजिक स्ट्रोक. इन जनरल पेशेंट ऑफ हेमरेजिक स्ट्रोक लुक्स मोर इल कंपेयर टू पेशेंट्स ऑफ इस्केमिक स्ट्रोक ऑफ सेम इंटेंसिटी. But bottom line, you cannot differentiate ischemic stroke from hemorrhagic stroke just on the basis of history or examination. So imaging is must in each and every case. So what is the investigation of choice? Whenever a patient is presenting with the acute onset focal neurological deficit and your clinical diagnosis is stroke. Basically, stroke is a clinical diagnosis. But what should be done next? Investigation of choice is non-contrast CT scan brain. Although sensitivity of CT scan is very low, only 16%, but specificity is very high, 96%. Because if a patient is having hemorrhage, CT scan will give you immediate idea of hemorrhage. But in case of ischemic stroke, CT may come normal, because we all know that in early ischemia, CT comes normal. But CT is needed just to take idea that patient is having bleed or not. There are some early signs in CT which suggest towards ischemia. These early signs are loss of gray-white interface. Just look on the right side, there is blurring between gray matter and white matter. On the left side, there is clear distinction between gray matter and white matter. This is called loss of gray-white interface. This is one of the early signs of ischemia. Second one is loss of sulci. On the left side, we can see the sulcal spaces are clearly visible, but on right side, sulci are obliterated. This is also one of the early signs of ischemia. Next one is hyperdense MCA sign. This patient presented with right-sided hemiparesis. If we see this CT scan, there is nothing abnormal, hyperdensity or hypodensity. But on left side, there is hyperdense curve. This hyperdensity is because of thrombus lying in the middle cerebral artery. And this is an early sign of ischemic stroke, and these patients usually develop large hypodensity in left frontotemporoparietal region. In CT, how can we differentiate between hemorrhage and ischemia? Grossly, hemorrhage looks bright in CT and ischemia looks hypodense. If CT is showing hyperdensity, we are sure that patient is having hemorrhagic stroke. Our treatment will be focused towards hemorrhagic stroke. But if CT is showing hypodensity or CT is normal, our suspicious should be towards ischemic etiology. These are some common sites of hypertensive bleed. Most common site of hypertensive bleed is basal ganglia. Next one is thalamus, cerebellum, and pons. These are the four common sites of hypertensive bleed. Then coming to MRI brain. MRI brain, particularly diffusion-weighted sequences, high sensitivity to identify the ischemia. It has almost 83% sensitivity. But if CT is not, if MRI is not available in-house, we should never ask for MRI in these cases if we want to treat patients of acute ischemic stroke in window period, because it takes lot of time and this is just wasting of time. Because on the basis of just CT scan finding, we can take decision whether we should want to thrombolyze the patient or not. So MRI brain is never needed for the acute management of stroke. So all patients which are admitted in our emergency with the clinical diagnosis of acute stroke should be subjected to urgent CT head, plain CT head, to differentiate between hemorrhage and ischemia, just to rule out bleed in CT, and CT will give you sufficient information to make decision about acute management of stroke. This is the etiological classification of ischemic stroke. When a patient presented with sudden onset focal deficit and we have done CT and CT is showing hypertensity or normal, and our doubt is clear that patient is having ischemic stroke, we categorize this patient into these five, among these five categories, because these are the probable etiologies of stroke. Hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol, these are the risk factor, not the etiology. In each and every case of stroke, we have to prove what is the underlying etiology of stroke. Basically, hypertension, diabetes, cholesterol are not an etiology. They are basically a risk factor. So, all patients of ischemic stroke should be subsequently subjected to vascular imaging to find out whether they are having some stenosis of intracranial or extracranial vasculature. If the vascular imaging is showing stenosis of more than 50%, we keep these patients into first category, large artery atherosclerosis. If imaging is showing lacunar infarcts, we keep these patients into the category of small vessel occlusion. Third category is cardioembolic strokes. If patient is having underlying atrial fibrillation, LV clot, LA clot, regional wall motion abnormality, or some valvular defect, in those cases we keep the patient into third category, cardioembolic strokes. And fourth category is some known vascular entity like vasculitis, dissection, and moya. If our whole workup is negative or our workup is incomplete, in those cases we keep the patient into fifth category, embolic stroke of undetermined source. Now coming to stroke mimics, before starting the acute management of ischemic stroke, we should always keep in mind some stroke mimics are there which may present as stroke. If, for example, if a patient of seizure disorder is presenting with sudden onset seizure followed by weakness on one side, in those cases it is possibility that patient may be having postictal Todd's palsy. So this may sometimes seizure may present as stroke. Another possibility is hyperglycemia and hypoglycemia. If patient is a known diabetic and is on oral hypoglycemic agent or insulin therapy, sometimes those patients present with acute onset weakness on one side, and when we check sugar is very low, and we give dextrose and patient immediately recovers. So always rule out these possibilities like hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia. Next entity is complicated migraine. In these cases may also sometimes present with acute onset focal neurological deficit, but in these cases patient will have severe headache at the time of presentation. Next is hypertensive encephalopathy. If patient is presenting with sudden onset severe headache, alteration in sensorium, vision loss, and seizure, there is high chance that patient is having hypertensive encephalopathy. In the same way, next entity is Wernicke's encephalopathy. Patient may present with sudden onset ataxia, ophthalmoplasia, or confusion. But there should be some underlying history of chronic alcoholism or malnutrition. In these scenario, we should suspect Wernicke's encephalopathy. Next, most important is conversion reaction. If a young lady is presenting with sudden onset focal neurological deficit and your examination is not congruent with the presentation, you should always keep in mind that there may be conversion reaction also. Two other examples are CNS absence and CNS tumor. If a patient is having pre-existing tumor in head and there is sudden intratumoral bleed, patient may present with sudden onset focal neurological deficit. So these are some stroke mimics. In these scenario, patient may also present with sudden onset focal neurological deficit. So coming to general physical examination, for patients who are suspected to have acute ischemic stroke, apart from general examination, vitals, temperature, oxygen saturation, we should look for any sign of seizure, trauma. Neck brew, examination for neck brew is very important, because if you find neck brew, it favors partial carotid or vertebral artery stenosis. Facial pulses should be looked for. Peripheral pulses, if a patient of suspected stroke is having absent pulses, we can suspect the patient is probably having atherosclerotic disease. If cardiac auscultation is showing you evidence of atrial fibrillation, murmur, or cardiomegaly, that can give you idea of cardioembolic source. General physical examination should be quickly followed by rapid nervous system examination. Then coming to the management of acute ischemic stroke. Apart from, like in every emergency, we also look at ABC in acute ischemic stroke cases. After stabilization of the patient, we define the severity of stroke. There is one scale, National Institute of Health Stroke Scale. This is 13-point scale in which we put numbering. That first 1A is level of consciousness, whether patient is alert, drowsy, obtendent, or coma. Next is orientation, response to command, gauge. This is basically a scale which is available online, also available on apps. And by calculating this scale, you can estimate the severity of stroke. If your score is 0 to 4, you can think of that stroke is minor. If your score is 5 to 15, you can think that patient is having moderate stroke. And if your score is more than 50, you can suspect that patient is having severe stroke, means large artery is occluded probably. What test should be done immediately in emergency when you face a patient of suspected acute ischemic stroke? Three most important tests are sugar, ECG and CT head. Sugar should be immediately estimated because patient may have hyperglycemia or hypoglycemia, and sometimes when we correct hypoglycemia, patient immediately recovers. So sugar estimation is most important. Next is ECG to rule out myocardial ischemia. And third one is CT to differentiate whether patient is having hemorrhage or ischemia. Rest all tests are done subsequently in particular scenario. For example, if patient is presenting with seizure at onset, we ask for EEG. If patient is having severe headache and our doubt is subarachnoid hemorrhage and CT scan is not showing any blood, in those cases we ask for lumbar puncture. So rest of the tests are done in a specific scenario. In general, three tests are most important: sugar, ECG and CT. Coming to the general management of patients with stroke, sugar. If patient is having low sugar, should be treated with 50% dextrose. If patient is having high sugar, insulin infusion should be given, and we keep the sugar between 140 to 180 with the help of insulin. IV fluids, normal saline is the fluid of choice. Oral intake, when you are dealing with acute ischemic stroke patient, keep the patient NPO until you assess swallowing. Oxygen, supplemental oxygen is needed only when saturation is less than 94%, and avoid hyperthermia. If patient is having fever, give antipyretics. Now coming to guidelines for BP management in acute ischemic stroke. Basically, never treat hypertension in acute ischemic stroke patient. BP treatment of BP is required only when BP is more than 220 by 120 or patient is having some evidence of impending target organ damage, like if patient is having myocardial ischemia, disc edema or renal failure. Only in those scenario or BP is more than 220 by 110, we will reduce the BP. Otherwise, we should not reduce BP in acute setup. This is the cerebral autoregulation curve. Dark line is showing that cerebral blood flow depends upon arterial pressure, and between 50 to 150 millimeter of mercury arterial pressure, the cerebral blood flow remains constant. Between this range, 50 to 150, cerebral blood flow remains constant. But what happens in stroke, when stroke happens, this curve becomes straight, dotted line, and cerebral blood flow becomes directly dependent upon arterial pressure. If we reduce the arterial pressure, cerebral blood flow will decrease. So if we are reducing the arterial pressure, ischemia will be more and infarct will be more severe. Then coming to drug therapy for acute ischemic stroke patient, from 1996 till date, only approved therapy for acute ischemic stroke is thrombolysis with tissue plasminogen activator. This is known as intravenous thrombolysis. And next treatment in acute phase is also coming in big way, is a endovascular therapy, also sometimes called endovascular treatment or mechanical thrombectomy. Other options are antithrombotic treatment like antiplatelets, anticoagulation, statins and neuroprotection. We will discuss one by one. First, thrombolysis. Because only approved treatment for acute ischemic stroke since 96 is IV TPA, tissue plasminogen activator. And if we treat patients of acute ischemic stroke within time window, 50 to 280 additional patient out of 1,000 patient will be alive and independent after 12 months compared to placebo. So who are the real candidate for thrombolysis? When patient is presenting with sudden onset focal neurological deficit, your clinical diagnosis is stroke, you ask for CT, CT is not showing any sign of bleed, and patient is presenting within window, 4.5 hours. These are some inclusion criteria. Patient should have clinical diagnosis of stroke, age should be greater than 18, and window should be less than 4.5 hours, and CT should not show any sign of bleed, and there should be written consent. Exclusion criteria. Which patient should not be thrombolyzed? If a patient is having history of stroke or head injury in previous 3 months, if patient has had hemorrhagic stroke in past, if patient has had history of arterial puncture in last 7 days, there is recent history of brain or spinal surgery, or patient is using some newer oral anticoagulants, if there is some active internal bleeding, If there is a strong doubt of subarachnoid hemorrhage, even if CT is normal, you should exclude these patients. If BP is persistently high beyond 185 by 110, if sugar is less than 50 or more than 400, if platelet counts are less than 1 lakh, if patient is taking warfarin and his INR is more than 1.7, and if patient has received heparin within 48 hours and APTT is elevated, these patients should be excluded from thrombolysis. There are some relative exclusion criteria. If a person who is going to thrombolyze the patient is well familiar with the procedure, in this scenario he can go ahead with the thrombolysis. But if you are not very much familiar, in this these patients should also be excluded. Like if patient is having rapidly improving stroke symptoms, if patient is pregnant, if patient is presenting with seizure at onset, or patient had major surgery in last 2 weeks, or patient has recently had acute MI within last 3 months, these patients should also be excluded from the IV thrombolysis category. Suppose these all contraindications are for patients who present within 3 hours. Suppose if patient is presenting beyond 3 hours but within 4.5 hours, these are some additional exclusion criteria, like age should not be more than 80 years, NIHS score should be less than 25, if patient is taking oral anticoagulants like warfarin, acetrome, regardless of INR, whatever may be the INR, these patients should be excluded. If patient is having history of both diabetes and prior ischemic stroke, these patients should be excluded. How we administer IV TPA, tissue plasminogen activator? Total dose is 0.9 mg per kg, maximum is 90. 10% dose is given as bolus and remaining dose is given over 1 hour. During thrombolysis, we keep close watch over BP and we keep BP below 185 by 110. We don't use antithrombotics, aspirin, clopidogrel for next 24 hours. And after thrombolyze a patient, don't catheterize for next 24 hours. And during thrombolysis or within next 24 hours, if there is decline in the neurological state or if patient complain of severe headache, we should immediately give cryoprecipitate and ask for urgent repeat CT. If a patient of acute ischemic stroke is presenting within the time window period and you are planning for thrombolyze that patient and or the exclusion criteria has been seen and patient is an ideal candidate for thrombolysis, but his BP is more than 185 by 110. In that case, you can use labetalol or nicardipine to reduce his BP. But if despite giving 2 shots of labetalol and nicardipine, his BP is not persistently low between 185 by 110, you cannot thrombolyze these patients. Next thrombolytic agent is tenecteplase, which is coming nowadays. This is genetically modified tissue plasminogen activator, although it is 9 times more fibrin specific, but that data is not sufficient and FDA has not approved this molecule for acute ischemic stroke, although it is already being used in acute myocardial infarction. DCGI India has approved this drug for minor strokes within 3 hours window period only. Problem with intravenous thrombolysis is that there is narrow time window. We have only 4.5 hours time window. Second, if suppose patient is having large vessel occlusion like middle cerebral artery occlusion, internal cerebral artery occlusion, in those cases IV thrombolysis is not sufficient to obtain recanalization. So in large vessel occlusion, usually IV thrombolysis fails. To overcome this situation, new technique is coming in big way, that is mechanical thrombectomy, endovascular revascularization. This is a stent retriever device known as solitaire device, and this is currently available at higher center only where interventionist is available. And with the help of this device, we can remove the clot from the ICA up to MCA and basilar artery. And advantage of this technique is that patients who have contraindication for intravenous thrombolyze, they can also have this procedure to prevent irreversible deficit of the neuron. And in patients who have intravenous thrombolysis have failed to achieve recanalization, and in acute ischemic stroke patient who have clinically large vessel occlusion, in these patients we can have this technique if we have this facility in our center. What we should done if a patient is presenting beyond 4.5 hours, in these cases another technique is CT perfusion study. if we have CT perfusion, basically CT perfusion nothing, this is simple CT, was added automated software which gives us a idea about ischemic penumbra. If we have this CT perfusion study, even if patient is presenting beyond 4.5 hours, 6 hours, 7 hours, with the help of this CT perfusion, we can see that whether patient is having ischemic penumbra or not. If CT perfusion is showing you the ischemic penumbra, you can go with the thrombolysis procedure. Another technique beyond 4.5 hours, if we have MRI and MRI is showing flare diffusion mismatch, in those cases, even if patient is presenting beyond 4.5 hours, you can go with the thrombolysis. Antiplatelet, aspirin is the only antiplatelet agent proven to be effective for acute treatment of AIs. There are multiple other antiplatelets which can be used for, but these all are for secondary prevention. They don't much help in acute setup. Anticoagulation, there is no role of anticoagulation in antithrombotic strokes. They should be used only in cardioembolic strokes. If vascular imaging is showing intraluminal thrombus, if patient is having arterial dissection, and this should be started after 4 days to within 14 days. There are various options for anticoagulation like unfractioned heparin, low molecular weight heparin, warfarin. Now newer oral anticoagulants are also available like dabigatran, rivaroxaban. Advantage of these newer oral anticoagulant is that we don't need frequent INR monitoring. Role of statin has been discussed very much. Neuroprotection, there are multiple agents available in the market, citicoline, paracetam, edaborant, but no agent till date is approved by FDA as a neuroprotective agent. Surgery, when should we refer the patient of acute ischemic stroke for surgery? If patient is having large hemispheric infarct with significant mass effect, those patients require decompressive hemicrectomy. And if patient is having large cerebral infarct, those patients require suboccipital craniotomy. So these two category of patients should be referred to neurosurgeon timely for decompression. Then coming to stroke rehabilitation, physiotherapy, occupational speech therapy, and prevention of complication of immobility. For secondary prevention, lifestyle modification, control of risk factor, hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia, medical treatment. For secondary prevention of stroke, statins, antiplatelets, anticoagulants, and treatment of underlying disease. Suppose vascular imaging is showing more than 50% stenosis in the carotids, we should refer these patients for these two procedures, carotid artery endarterectomy and carotid artery stenting, to reduce the risk of recurrence. Then this is single slide for the management of hemorrhagic stroke. If patient is having hypertensive bleed, only proven treatment is control of BP. Rest all is just for the investigation to know the cause of etiology of hemorrhage. If etiology is hypertension, just control BP, rest all is supportive, but we should look for some underlying malformation, aneurysm, and treat accordingly. Management of venous stroke, mainstay of treatment is heparin. We should use IV heparin. Even if patient is having hemorrhage in the brain, in these cases we use heparin. But if despite giving heparin there is no recanalization, sometimes we refer the patient for thrombectomy. And if venous infarct is large, sometimes we ask for decompression. So stroke is the leading cause of disability and mortality. Timely management is must to prevent long-term morbidity and mortality. Almost 85% of strokes are ischemic strokes. Thrombolysis is the mainstay of therapy for acute ischemic stroke, and in proper setting, mechanical thrombectomy is best option for management even beyond window, and awareness about stroke and its management is mandatory to improve stroke outcome. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the informative talk. Because of paucity of time, we don't have time for question answer session. Next, I'd like to invite Dr. G.S. Gill, DM Cardiology Consultant, Pragma Multispeciality Hospital, Bathinda, to kindly deliver his talk on pulmonary embolism, what to do.
Good afternoon, friends. First of all, I thank organizers, especially Dr. Vithal Gupta, who has, infused or pumped me to be here, the practice which I left 10 years ago. So it is because of his persistence that I am here, and I am very thankful. So I'm presenting a very I won't say common, but a very good clinical problem, pulmonary embolism. So pulmonary embolism, the name itself used to scare me when I was like doing MD or DM, and even in private practice. So I'm sure it must be same to the physician audience sitting here. The name pulmonary embolism, what we used to take it is that, oh, it is very rare. Was the patient the end aa gaya, bas pulmonary embolism means everything is gone. And if somebody used to like there's a practice here, the patient the pata leke dasso ji ki hai, and if the responding physician says that it is pulmonary embolism, ta ehi communication bas utha gaya ji, pulmonary embolism gaya. So there are some myths about this, that's why I have chosen this topic. So the first myth is that this is very very rare disease. So it's not very very rare disease. On an average, we are picking up 1.5, like 18 patients per year of pulmonary embolism we are diagnosing in our center. So this tendency is relatively increasing. And for the last 10 years, we have treated more than 100 patients of pulmonary embolism in our center. And the second myth is that it is very high mortality. So this is also not actually true. If we manage or timely diagnose these patients, we can save up to 80 to 90% of these patients. Now coming to the epidemiology, the magnitude of this problem, pulmonary embolism and DVT, both they are classified as venous thromboembolism. So venous thromboembolism along with coronary artery disease, cerebrovascular disease and peripheral arterial disease, this whole constitutes pancardiovascular syndrome. So DVT, pulmonary embolism, is the third most frequent acute cardiovascular event after MI and stroke. This is an interesting slide. 59% of deaths due to acute pulmonary embolism are actually diagnosed after the death of the patient, so on autopsy. Another 34% of the patients die suddenly within few hours after the onset of pulmonary embolism before a treatment could be started. So these two, for 59% of patients diagnosed after the death, and 34% even if you diagnose, they die before the start of the treatment. So this, it seems that there is high mortality in pulmonary embolism, but these are fortunately only 5 to 10% of the patients present like this. Like this is massive pulmonary embolism. So if we take the whole scenario of pulmonary embolism, massive pulmonary embolism accounts for only 5 to 10% of the patient. The majority comes from the intermediate or low category, and in those patients the mortality is less than 3 to 4%. So overall mortality, if we see 7% mortality is case fatality ratio, if we calculate, it turns out to be 7% in pulmonary embolism. So there are long term risks even if you treat the acute event. Age match controls are compared in studies, and the mortality is 32% at 5 years. Pulmonary embolism, majority of the time it is idiopathic. 50% of the cases are idiopathic, but cancer patients are also prone to have pulmonary embolism. So risk of cancer detection is 2% per year. And if once a patient has pulmonary embolism, if you discontinue the anticoagulation, there is a 10% risk of recurrent pulmonary embolism after discontinuation of anticoagulation. And chronic thrombopulmonary embolism, chronic thromboembolic pulmonary hypertension is an entity where this ongoing phenomenon is chronic, and it is seen in 2 to 4% of the patient. So classification of pulmonary embolism, as I already told, the massive pulmonary embolism accounts for only 5 to 10% of the patients, and it happens when more than 50% of the pulmonary vasculature is involved. On CT, there is either central saddle-like thrombosis or right and left, or either of the main pulmonary artery has thrombus. And the clinically, this patient presents as refractory shock and multi-organ failure. And these patients have high early mortality, more than 30%. And these are the patients who are diagnosed on autopsy sometimes and die before the treatment is started. Submassive pulmonary embolism accounts for 20 to 25% of the cases, and at least 1/3 of the pulmonary vasculature is involved in these patients. These patients are characteristically hemodynamically stable. Hemodynamically stable means BP is around 90, 100, more than 90. and on echo these patients have RV enlargement. Small pulmonary embolism constitute majority of the patients, and these patients have normal hemodynamics, normal RV size and function. So clinically it is not possible to pick up these patients. The only this group constitutes like patient who have dyspnea and we don't find any cause, X-ray is normal, ECG is normal, echo is normal, and we don't go for CT and you to prove whether this patient has pulmonary embolism or not. So these are the group which constitute majority of the patients. Now this the previous classification was in 2000 up to 2014 guideline. Now the guidelines for pulmonary embolism have been revised, and European Society of Cardiology has published the 2019 guidelines 1 month ago, where the pulmonary embolism has been classified into high, intermediate and low group based on hemodynamical instability, clinical pulmonary embolism severity index, RV dysfunction on echo or CT angio, and elevated TROP-T or BNP. So patients, I would first like to tell this pulmonary embolism severity index. It is a long questionnaire, but it is has been now simplified. Simplified pulmonary embolism severity index. It constitutes six things: age more than 80, cancer and COPD, pulse rate more than 110, BP below 100, and saturation below 90. Out of these six, if either one is present, then there is a high risk of pulmonary embolism. So if a patient is hemodynamically unstable, so it comes under high mortality risk. A patient who is hemodynamically unstable, he will have this pulmonary embolism severity index more than one. He or she will have RV dysfunction on echo, and troponins will obviously be elevated. But a patient who doesn't have hemodynamical instability, these patients have more than 1 point in the severity index. On echo, they have RV dysfunction and troponin was elevated, then they become high risk category in this intermediate group. And if a patient doesn't have hemodynamical instability but has one out of these six risk factors and has either echo or CT angio positive, this becomes a low risk patient because this BP is stable, and these patients have very less mortality, even less than 1 to 2%. So this is a diagram which is showing how this cascade happens. There is a mechanical obstruction of the pulmonary artery leading to RV pressure overload, and there is RV dilatation, tricuspid regurgitation, decreased left ventricular inflow, decreased left ventricular preload, hypotension, less coronary perfusion leading to RVM infarction, RV myocardial ischemia, and this leads to further RV dysfunction, and this vicious cycle goes on leading to death of the patient. The pulmonary embolism, clinically patient presents with dyspnea. You know, dyspnea is a very common problem, starting from, you know, patients can have anxiety, neurosis, hyperventilation, and at the same time patients with pulmonary embolism can have dyspnea. So dyspnea, pulmonary embolism patients have, all patients have dyspnea. Dyspnea is a presenting symptom, but at the same time, good history and high index of clinical suspicion and clinical examination is absolutely necessary to pick up the pulmonary embolism, as well as not to over investigate the patient. So this requires a skillful history taking, I would say. A patient who has a recent onset dyspnea, and dyspnea in pulmonary embolism is very classic. Patient is totally comfortable when sitting at bed. There's no orthopnea, but the moment he tries to get up and go to washroom or, you know, try to change his clothes, he becomes so dyspneic. Like patient coming to the hospital, comfortably sitting in his ambulance or car, when try to shift to the emergency room, he becomes totally dyspneic. And at the same time, patients of, there are other causes of sudden onset dyspnea like pneumothorax, you know, acute MI, LVF, valvular heart disease. Those all causes have to be excluded. So syncope is the second common presentation. Syncope is classically postural syncope. There's no arrhythmic syncope. And patients can present with chest pain due to RV ischemia or pleuritic. So a patient who comes with dyspnea, sudden onset dyspnea and severe dyspnea but no orthopnea, and has hypotension, tachycardia or saturation below 94%, On examination, chest is clear. I mean, there's no Krebs, bilateral, normal vesicular breath sounds are heard. These are the patients who should strongly be suspected to have pulmonary embolism. And echocardiography is must in these patients after doing ECG and chest X-ray. So ECG is non-specific. Classically, what we told, like S1Q, T3 pattern, this is hardly seen in more than 20 to 30% of the patients. So whatever we teaching we had, like pulmonary embolism, S1Q, 3T3, this doesn't fit in more than 20% of the patients. So sometimes only tachycardia, sinus tachycardia is the only abnormality in seen in 40% of the patients. Evidence of RV strain by RBB, T inversion in V1 to V4 can sometimes be found, but many a times ECG can be totally misleading. But ECG helps in ruling out other causes of dyspnea, like acute MI, ACS, so those can be excluded from ECG. So the baseline investigation, ECG followed by chest X-ray to rule out other causes of dyspnea. So D-dimer is again a very useful test, but D-dimer is used to exclude the diagnosis of pulmonary embolism. Patients who are hemodynamically unstable or like who are hospitalized patients in ICU or pregnant patients or patients suffering from any infection, pneumonia, inflammatory disease, these patients will already have high D-dimers. So even if you do D-dimer in these patients, they will be elevated. So you will not be able to diagnose or exclude pulmonary embolism. So D-dimer is useful in low-risk patients whom you suspect that pulmonary embolism is unlikely, and you do D-dimer, and D-dimer is normal, that means pulmonary embolism is not there. So nowadays, age-adjusted cutoffs are more useful. If a patient is more than 50 years of age, the age into 10 should be the cutoff. Like normally we take 500, more than 500 microgram per liter positive D-dimer as a positive. But if patient is of 60, then the cutoff should be 600. And if you're a patient of age 70, the cutoff should be 700. So echo is the mainstay of investigation. Acute patients with the acute pulmonary embolism will have RV dilatation, RV dysfunction. But there is no single parameter on echo who can reliably differentiate between other causes of RV enlargement. Like RV enlargement can have in core pulmonary also, RV enlargement can have in left-sided valvular heart disease, LVF, LV dysfunction. So again, echo cannot help to diagnose, but it is useful in ruling out other causes of acute dyspnea and core pulmonary. But a patient who does not have other history of other disease, and you see RV dilatation and RV dysfunction and tricuspid regurgitation, and you have hypotension and classical history, you must investigate on the lines of pulmonary embolism. So this is a diagram showing, RV dilatation. This is showing RV dilatation. Normally RV is 1/3 of LV. But if RV becomes equivalent to LV or greater than LV, that means RV dilatation is there. Mobile thrombi can be seen in 2-3% of the patients. Two of our patients also had mobile thrombi in RA and RV. So I will show it later on. So next, if you see RV dilatation on echo, then CT pulmonary angio is the next investigation of choice. It is very reliable investigation. It has a good sensitivity and specificity of 83 and 96%. DVT is seen only in up to 50% of the patients. Lung perfusion scan is not widely available. Pulmonary angiography is not an investigation of choice nowadays. MR angio also fails to pick up thrombus in the pulmonary arteries. Markers of myocardial injury, troponins, BNP and NT-proBNP are elevated, but they don't lead to the diagnosis. Treatment is like management of hypotension, hypoxia, oxygen therapy, fluid replacement, inotropic support, and sometimes patient requires mechanical ventilation, and who patient who have cardiac arrest, survivor of cardiac arrest, they are better managed with ECMO and Impella. These are basically external heart failure devices, so not widely available. So the main treatment is initially patient whom we suspect to have pulmonary embolism, unfractionated heparin should be given immediately In the meantime, patient should be investigated. Like patient who has been shifted for echocardiography and you suspect pulmonary embolism, it is better to give heparin and then shift the patient. And once we prove that patient is having pulmonary embolism, reperfusion therapy is the main treatment of choice. In reperfusion therapy, we have a choice of systemic thrombolysis, percutaneous catheter-guided treatment, or surgical embolectomy. So thrombolysis, there are three agents available: recombinant tissue plasminogen activator, streptokinase, and urokinase. This table shows contraindications of fibrinolysis and dosage of these thrombolytic agents, but I would not focus on that. I would like to share interesting experience. Like when I started diagnosing pulmonary embolism patients in somewhere in 2008 and 2009, a young patient after a short illness of I think malaria came to me with dyspnea. Patient was very much referred by Dr. Paramjit Mittal sitting behind. So the patient had shock and hypotension, and he came to us, and we suspected on echo that he is having pulmonary embolism. So patient was sick, so there was no question of doing CT angio, and patient was 24 years of age. So I explained the family that he needs a TPA, and when it comes to the cost, it turns out to be 80,000 because two vials are required. So 80,000, 90,000. So within, you know, 20-30 minutes, the patient went to Fortis Mohali. After that, I stopped advising recombinant tissue plasminogen activator because streptokinase has also the same effect. So I will show my data also. We treated almost 100 patients with streptokinase with very good results. So percutaneous catheter directed treatment is actually a class 2A indication. So you won't find any cardiologist who is discouraging percutaneous catheter directed treatment. It is more of a fantasy, because the guidelines has recommended systemic thrombolysis as class 1 indication, surgical embolectomy also class 1 indication in patients in whom thrombolysis is contraindicated. Catheter directed pulmonary catheter inserting and giving thrombolysis is actually discouraged and is a class 2 indication. So this table again shows what I've already told, that unfractionated heparin should be given, and systemic thrombolysis is class 1 indication, surgical pulmonary embolectomy is again class 1 indication, and percutaneous catheter directed treatment is actually class 2 indication. So this table shows the treatment of acute phase in patients with intermediate and low risk. And the main point is that reperfusion therapy is class 3 indication. Like reperfusion therapy is not recommended in patients with low or intermediate low risk category. So reperfusion therapy is only recommended in high risk and intermediate high risk. Intermediate is actually classified into two. So low risk patients are to be managed with only anticoagulation. So routine use of IVC filter is again class 2A indication. It's not recommended. Routine use of IVC filter is actually class 3. In patients in whom thrombolysis is contraindicated, or who patients in which there is a recurrence of pulmonary embolism despite adequate anticoagulation, in those patients IVC filters are recommended. So this is a table showing which we have already discussed. A patient with hemodynamic instability, first you do bedside echo, and if there is RV dysfunction, you should, if there is no RV dysfunction, that rules out pulmonary embolism. If there is RV dysfunction and CT is available, you should get the CT pulmonary angio done. Even if it is not available, you can directly treat these patients with streptokinase without getting CT angio done. But if CT angio is available, it should be done. And if it is positive, again, thrombolysis should be given. If it is negative, it rules out. So in a patient without hemodynamic instability, D-dimer is the main test, which I have already told. If a patient who has low probability and if D-dimer is negative, that rules out pulmonary embolism. So now chronic treatment for the prevention of recurrence. So once you treat the patient with the thrombolysis, oral anticoagulation has to be continued for 3 months in every patient. These oral anticoagulations are highly effective in preventing recurrence of thromboembolic event. But once you discontinue, the recurrence is again there. So various studies have discussed the duration of anticoagulation. They have found that once you discontinue the anticoagulation, the recurrence is going to be there. Whether you continue anticoagulation for 3 months, 6 months, 12 months or 4 months, the risk of recurrence is same. So even if you stop after 3 months, the recurrence of risk is same. Even if you stop after 1 year, the recurrence of risk is same. So now it is recommended that you stop the anticoagulation after 3 months. If you continue the anticoagulation beyond 3 months, you can reduce the recurrence of venous thromboembolism by 90%, but the risk of bleeding also increases. So that benefit is offset by anticoagulation related bleeding. Anticoagulation related bleeding is 3% per year, and newer anticoagulants have reduced the risk of bleeding by 40%. But the patients who have advanced age, previous bleeding, active cancer, previous stroke, renal failure, liver disease, concomitant antiplatelet therapy or steroid therapy, or other serious acute or chronic illness, or poor anticoagulation control, these are the category of patients who have high bleeding risk. So patient with these bleeding risk should have discontinuation of antiplatelets after anticoagulation after 3 months. So the approach has to be individualized, weighing the balance and benefits of continuation of anticoagulation and risk of bleeding after prolonged anticoagulation. So I skip these slides. Now coming to our own center experience. As I already told you that we had seen more than 100 patients of pulmonary embolism, but we lost the data before 2016. So I'm presenting only 3 years or 8 months data. In 3 years and 8 months, we have seen, we had this 54 patients, and I have already told that we used to diagnose one patient per month. Now we are diagnosing 1.5 patients per month. And the average age of our patient is, youngest patient was 24 years and the elderly patient was 85 years. Majority of the patients, if we see 33% of our patients are below 50 years, and 33 plus 24, 57% of the patients are below 60 years. This is in sharp contrast to the Western studies, where they say that the disease of pulmonary embolism is a disease of elderly age. We have only 6% of the patients who are more than 80 years of age. Predisposing factor was seen in only in 48%. Majority of the patients are idiopathic pulmonary embolism. And on an average, there was 5 to 6 days delay in patient coming to our center, dyspnea being managed here and there, but not thought of pulmonary embolism. So dyspnea was seen in 100% of our patients. All of our patients, many of our patients have syncope and hypoxia and tachycardia and shock. I have mentioned these figures. We did echo, and basic our suspicion started from echo. All of our patients had dilated RARV. Then we proceeded with CT angio, and earlier we used to get CT angio in every patient, but later on, like patient who had renal failure, or we were so sure of the diagnosis that this is pulmonary embolism, we treated many patients without getting CT angio also. Streptokinase infusion is the main treatment of choice, which only one patient in whom there was contraindication streptokinase, we managed with the heparin only. In hospital mortality was 11% in our patients, and two of our patients had recurrence after discontinuation of anticoagulation. Major bleed was seen in 3.7%. One patient had cerebellar hemorrhage, and two patients had GI bleed. We see two patients of lung abscess. Lung abscess is an interesting complication. Like, once we thrombolyze the patient, thrombus goes further into the pulmonary vessels, and at the periphery, it causes infarction of the pulmonary vasculature, and there abscess develops. We have to put a pigtail catheter to drain this lung abscess. One of this patient treated by us, and one went to DMC. So the take-home message is, pulmonary embolism is not very rare, and pulmonary embolism is not synonymous to mortality. High index of suspicion is required to diagnose pulmonary embolism, and echo should be done after doing chest X-ray in any patient with new onset significant dyspnea with or without hypotension. And treatment of pulmonary embolism is relatively affordable, and with early diagnosis we can prevent mortality. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. If any queries are there, you can just ask. Thank you, sir. Now the next we have Dr. Swaranjit Kaur Gill, DM Nephrology, Consultant, Pragma Multi-Speciality Hospital, Bathinda, and the topic is Management of Urinary Tract Infections in Primary Care.
So very good afternoon to all the audience present, and my special thanks to organizing committee of MEPICON Bathinda and Dr. Vital Gupta in particular to for this privilege. So topic that I have been given to speak on is management of urinary tract infections in primary care. So my topic would kindly demand the audience to suddenly shift their attention from high profile vascular diseases like CVA and pulmonary embolism to low profile dormant bacterial infections. And another disappointing thing is there is no new development in the management of UTIs in the last few decades. So what I am going to do is refresh what you already know about the management of UTIs. So we are going to discuss this topic under these headings with a particular attention about few terms like what is significant bacteriuria, what is asymptomatic bacteriuria, when it should be treated and when not, how do we manage the recurrent UTIs with a particular attention to the urinary tract infections in pregnancy, and few slides about the management of upper urinary tract infections. So UTI, as we all know, is a symptomatic infection of urinary tract. It may be urethra, bladder, ureters, or with or without involvement of the kidneys. So UTIs are the commonest bacterial infections seen in the primary care, and these are the commonest bacterial infections for which the antibiotics are prescribed. So why the topic of UTI? There are many studies that have shown that management of UTIs in the primary care is many a times inappropriate. Appropriate diagnostic tests are not employed to diagnose UTI. Many a times more than required number of urine cultures are sent. Second choice of drugs are often used which are unnecessary. Longer than required treatment courses are given to the patients, and many a times irrational medications are used, so which is not required. Treatment and diagnosis and management of UTI is very simple, and many a times we complicate it at the level of primary care. So this table shows the prevalence of UTIs, and we all know the prevalence of UTI is far more common in females in the all age groups. And this prevalence is higher in the females of the reproductive age group, and then the prevalence rises after the age of 60 years in the postmenopausal females. While the prevalence is much, much lower in males of all the age groups, in males, the incidence of UTI rises only after the age of 60 years, and this is because of the prostate enlargement which leads to urinary tract obstruction after the age of 60 years. So there could be two routes of infection of UTI, and by far the commonest route is ascending route of infection. 99% of UTIs are caused by ascending route. The most of the uropathogens are common commensals in the gut. So these bacteria, they migrate from the gut to colonize the periurethral and the perineal skin. And colonization is defined as asymptomatic presence of bacteria in the periurethral and the perineal skin. So colonization is a very common phenomena. After colonization, whether the UTI will occur or not, it depends upon the balance between the bacterial virulence factors and the host defense mechanisms. So whenever the bacterial virulence factors override the host defense mechanism, colonization is followed by the UTI. So UTI also has a, whenever there is uropathogens, they enter into the urethra and they attach to the uroepithelium, then they ascend into the bladder, then there is an inflammatory response by the host. So combination of these two factors leads to symptoms of the UTI. So hematogenous spread of UTI is very, very rare, and it is seen in less than 1% of the cases. And the anatomic short length of urethra in females is clearly responsible for high prevalence of UTIs in females, and also association of UTIs that is seen with the sexual intercourse. So the causative organisms, we are all aware, that the most common uropathogen that causes urinary tract infections accounting for 80% of the cases is E. coli. Escherichia coli causes 80% of cases of UTI. Second most common cause of UTI seen in the community acquired infection is the Staphylococcus saprophyticus. This is the common pathogen seen in the females, young females of the reproductive age group. And the treatment of this is gram-positive bacteria, so treatment of this type of infection is different from the other type of UTIs. While these less common organisms like Klebsiella, Proteus, Pseudomonas, Enterococcus, these organisms are mostly responsible for the complicated form of UTIs and the hospital-acquired urinary tract infections, while majority of the community-acquired UTIs are caused by either E. coli or Staphylococcus saprophyticus. So this table again shows the type of uropathogens according to the type of UTI. Most uncomplicated UTIs are caused by E. coli, while complicated UTIs are caused by either resistant E. coli or Pseudomonas acinetobacter. Catheter-associated UTIs and recurrent UTIs are mostly caused by the Proteus mirabilis. So whenever we see in our outdoor OPD, whenever we encounter a patient of urinary tract infection, we need to classify whether the patient is experiencing a lower UTI or an upper UTI. So lower UTI is infection of urethra and bladder. Whenever there is involvement of the kidneys, we label it as upper UTI, which is also known as pyelonephritis. So both lower and upper UTI, they are further classified into complicated versus uncomplicated. So if we label a UTI as complicated, whenever there is some kind of structural or functional abnormality of the urinary tract. So both lower and upper UTI can be either complicated or uncomplicated. So what are the conditions that label UTI as complicated? So any patient who is having an indwelling catheter is labeled as having complicated UTI. UTI is occurring in a patient with diabetes mellitus, all type of UTI are considered as complicated UTIs. Any UTI in male gender is complicated UTI. UTI occurring in a child, any boy or girl at an age of less than 12 years of age is considered as a complicated UTI. UTI in the presence of renal failure, in the presence of renal stones, if there is any history of urinary tract surgery, UTI occurring in a pregnant female is a complicated UTI. So UTI in the presence of voiding dysfunction, like patients who are having neurogenic bladder dysfunction, which may be either congenital or acquired due to spinal cord injuries, these patients are considered to have complicated UTIs. UTI in any patient who is on immunosuppression, like transplant patients, these are complicated UTIs. Or any type of congenital anomalies of the urinary tract, if UTI occur in its presence, it is labeled as a complicated UTI. So we have to take care whether UTI is happening in the presence of these predisposing conditions, then it is not a simple UTI, then it is labeled as a complicated UTI and treatment is altogether different. So symptoms we all know. UTI might present with a broad range of symptoms. Patient may be totally asymptomatic, and this term is referred to as asymptomatic bacteriuria. Patients who have a lower UTI, they have typical local symptoms, like they present with severe painful micturition called dysuria, urgency of urine, frequency of urine. Patients who have cystitis, they have suprapubic pain and discomfort. And one-third of the patients with cystitis, they may present with gross hematuria. So UTI is one of the differential diagnoses of patients who are presenting with sudden onset gross hematuria. So gross hematuria does not always caused by some urological problems. UTI is one of the important differential diagnoses of gross hematuria. So those patients who have an upper UTI like pyelonephritis, they always have systemic symptoms. So if a patient is presenting with local symptoms and along with fever, chills and rigors, a flank pain and tenderness, then it points towards involvement of the kidneys and patient is likely to have pyelonephritis, and again the treatment plan in these patients would be different. So uncommon presentation of UTI which is seen in elderly and catheterized patient is sudden change in sensorium. An elderly patient who is on a periurethral indwelling catheter, the only presenting symptom of UTI may be the sudden change in sensorium. Patient might not be any having any fever, no symptoms of dysuria or suprapubic discomfort. Patient will present with sudden delirium. So any elderly patient on catheter presenting with sudden delirium might be having a urinary tract infection, not necessarily any neurological diagnosis. So diagnosis of UTI is very, very simple. It is based on classic symptoms of UTI with the help of urine microscopy, and urine culture is not always required for diagnosing UTI. So patient who has classic symptoms of UTI and urine microscopy reveals more than 10 WBCs per ml of the uncentrifuged urine or more than 5 WBCs per high power field of the urine sediment. So we have to see in the urine analysis if it is done on the urine sediment or if it is done on the uncentrifuged urine. In uncentrifuged urine, we need more than 10 WBCs for diagnosing UTI. In the urine sediment, we need more than 5 WBCs per high power field. So symptoms of UTI plus findings of urine analysis, these two things are sufficient to diagnose the case of UTI without any report of urine culture. And another thing is pyuria is not always specific for cystitis. I'm going to discuss later what might be the other causes of pyuria. Another two important tests that we can use for diagnosing UTI, these are the dipstick test for nitrites and dipstick test for leukocyte esterase. Nitrite test is basically based on a reduction of nitrates into nitrites by the bacteria which are present in the urine, and these are detected by dipsticks. Majority of the uropathogens that cause UTI, they convert nitrates into nitrites, and the test may be false negative if it is a UTI is caused by the bacteria which does not produce nitrite like Streptococcus faecalis. And another important factor in which test will not be positive is if patient is unable to hold the urine for a period of more than 4 hours, because patients of UTI, they have a symptom of urgency, they frequently void. So they are unable to hold the urine for a long time. So if they are not holding urine in the bladder for the long time, the test may be false negative. So positive nitrite test indicates presence of more than 10 bacteria per ml of urine. And another test is called leukocyte esterase test. And this test is based on the release of leukocyte esterase. This is an enzyme released from the lysed neutrophils. Any patient of UTI has abundance of neutrophils in the urine. And sometimes when the urine analysis is delayed, the neutrophils get lysed and the urine microscopy is false negative. So this advantage of this leukocyte esterase test is that even if the urine microscopy is negative for the pus cells, the leukocyte esterase test will be positive, because even if the cells are lysed, the enzyme will be released from these cells and the test will come out to be positive. So false positive test can be seen if there is vaginal contamination of the urine. So if we combine these two tests, they carry a very high sensitivity and specificity for diagnosing a case of UTI, and they carry a very high negative predictive value. Both these tests are negative. Chances, 98% chances that patient does not have a UTI. So urine culture, although we consider urine culture as a gold standard for the diagnosis of UTI, the important thing that I'm going to highlight here, that the routine use of urine culture in primary care and outdoor setting is not recommended. In any patient of UTI, uncomplicated UTI, we need not send the urine culture. We can treat the patient without urine culture. So it is not required for the diagnosis and treatment of urinary tract infection. Why? Because it increases the overall cost of treatment. Number two, treatment is started empirically even before we get the results of urine culture, and treatment is completed even before the culture results are available. So culture is practically unnecessary to diagnose and treat UTIs. But there are few conditions in which culture is recommended. Whenever there is suspicion of upper tract involvement, if there is any suspicion of pyelonephritis, we should send urine culture before starting the empirical antibiotic therapy. If patient does not respond to the antibiotic course, then we have to send the urine culture before changing the antibiotic. In those patients who are experiencing recurrent episodes of UTI, in any patient who is having a complicated UTI, and for the purpose of surveillance of the causative organisms and for study of the antibiotic resistant patterns, in routine outdoor practice, urine culture is unnecessary. and patient can be managed empirically. So few words about the significant bacteriuria. This term was coined by Kass in 1956, and the purpose was to differentiate contaminated urine from truly infected urine. So while collecting samples of urine, contamination is very frequent because bacteria causing UTI are frequently present in the periurethral and the perineal skin, and urine samples frequently get contaminated. So presence of bacteria in urine does not always mean infection. So quantification of bacteria and differentiation of the type of bacteria is very important to find out whether patient is having a true infection or not. So significant bacteriuria, this is how we define significant bacteriuria or a positive culture in a male or a female. In female, we require two consecutive midstream urine samples, and they should be having a colony count of at least 10^5 per ml of urine. While in men, single culture is sufficient, single culture with a colony count of 10^5. And in a patient which sample is taken with in and out catheterization, only 100 CFU per ml is considered as significant. So this is the definition of a positive culture. And there is slight modification of significant bacteriuria in females who have symptoms of UTI. In women who have classic symptoms of cystitis or urethritis, in these patients, urine culture with a colony count of 1000^10^4 are also considered as positive cultures, and these females should be labeled as having UTI and they should be treated with the antibiotics. So results of urine cultures are not very simple to interpret, and they should always be interpreted in terms of what was the method of urine collection, if there is any contamination of the urine, if it contains a single bacterial species or if it is a mixed sample. If there is a mixed bacterial colonies, then most likely it is a contaminated sample. What are the results of urine microscopy, if there is any associated pyuria or not, and what is the clinical situation, if patient is having symptoms of UTI or not. So cultures should be interpreted in all these contexts. So there are few clinical conditions that mimic UTI, particularly in males who are having chlamydial and gonococcal urethritis. They will be having classical symptoms of UTI. They might be having symptoms of dysuria and frequency of urine, and urine microscopy will reveal abundance of pus cells, but the cultures will be consistently negative. So these patients need to be differentiated from UTI, because management of gonococcal and chlamydial urethritis is very different from that of bacterial UTIs. And in females, vulvovaginitis caused by candida and trichomonas may be confused with UTI. And careful history taking helps to differentiate this vulvovaginitis from UTI, because these patients will typically have external dysuria, which is caused by passage of urine across the inflamed labia. They will not be having typical dysuria that the patients of UTI are having. They will have external dysuria. There will be no frequency or urgency of urine. They will not be having any suprapubic discomfort, and they have additional symptoms of vaginal discomfort and vaginal discharge. So careful history taking helps to distinguish patients of vaginitis from cystitis. So another common syndrome which we frequently see in the OPD is acute urethral syndrome. Many a times we see female patients presenting with typical symptoms of UTI. They have classic symptoms of dysuria, frequency, and we are unable to identify any cause of this dysuria and frequency. Their urine examination is perfectly normal. There is no pyuria. Their cultures are repeatedly negative. So far, no cause of this syndrome has been found, and no treatment has been found for this syndrome. There are many causes that have been postulated, some non-specific inflammation of the bladder, muscular dysfunction, or some psychological origin of this syndrome. This may be due to allergy or cold weather, some anxiety, stress, trauma, and in elderly females, it may be due to senile atrophy of the periurethral glands. Many types of therapies have been tried, but none is successful in these patients. So coming to the treatment of UTI. So while treating a patient of UTI, least toxic, least expensive drug should be used for shortest duration. So in primary care, UTIs are treated empirically. Diagnosis is based on symptoms and confirmed with urine microscopy, and always use a short course of therapy. Short course is effective, it is less toxic, it ensures better compliance, and it also causes less damage to the physiologic flora of the patient. So there is nothing new. The age-old drugs are as effective as they were decades ago. The first-line drugs which are used for treatment of uncomplicated UTIs are fosfomycin, nitrofurantoin, and ceftriaxone. Fluoroquinolones are still considered as a second-line therapy, and they are better reserved for complicated UTIs and upper urinary tract infections. Nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone and fosfomycin, they have a very low level of resistance even now because they have a narrow spectrum of activity. So in an uncomplicated lower UTI, a single dose of fosfomycin of 3 gram given at bedtime is safe and it is very effective. Only disadvantage is this drug is very expensive. And it is not used in males. It is effective in females. Another second drug which is effective is nitrofurantoin, which is given typically 100 milligram twice a day for 5 days. It is effective against majority of the uropathogens. But two points that are noted in the while using nitrofurantoin is that its antimicrobial activity is limited to the urinary tract. It does not achieve good tissue concentration. So this drug is ineffective in the upper urinary tract infection. So whenever there is any suspicion of pyelonephritis, nitrofurantoin should not be used. Second thing, if the patient is having a creatinine clearance of less than 60, if the patient is having renal failure, the drug is practically ineffective because nitrofurantoin will not be secreted into the urine. So drug won't be effective. In my daily clinical practice, I see many patients with a creatinine of 2, 2.5. They have been prescribed nitrofurantoin for the treatment of UTI and patient does not respond and then patient is referred. So whenever the creatinine is more than 1.5, nitrofurantoin is practically not effective for the treatment of UTI and it should not be used. And the third drug that is effective is ceftriaxone, combination of sulfamethoxazole and trimethoprim. A double strength tablet given twice a day for 3 days is very effective for the treatment of UTI and it is effective against all the pathogens except enterococcus. And the drug should not be used in pregnancy. Fluoroquinolones, all fluoroquinolones are very effective for the treatment of UTI. Short course of 3 days is very effective. They are also effective against upper tract infections as well as complicated infections, but should be avoided in pregnancy. So first line drugs still are fosfomycin, nitrofurantoin, and ceftriaxone. And they can be used empirically without sending urine cultures. So coming to asymptomatic bacteriuria, many a times we keep on screening patients for presence of bacteria, and if we find bacteria, we treat these patients. So asymptomatic bacteriuria is presence of significant bacteriuria, but in the absence of any clinical symptoms of UTI. So this asymptomatic bacteriuria is very common in certain groups of patients like diabetic patients, elderly patients, patients who have some kind of bladder dysfunction like neurogenic bladder, patients who are on indwelling catheters, and those patients who have suffered spinal cord injuries. These patients will continuously, they will have bacteriuria in the urine, but they will not have any symptoms of UTI. So it is very important to not to treat these patients for UTI because there is no benefit of treating these patients. And the risk is there will be development of resistance to the common antibiotics which are available for the treatment of UTI. So never screen these patients for the presence of asymptomatic bacteriuria. And if asymptomatic bacteriuria is found, it should not be treated. It should be left as such because this is not going to harm the patients and antibiotic therapy is not going to help the patients. Only three conditions in which asymptomatic bacteriuria should be treated are: number one is children, because in children, asymptomatic bacteriuria, it leads to the development of scarring of kidneys and future development of hypertension and renal failure. So asymptomatic bacteriuria should always be treated in children. Number two, pregnant woman. In pregnant woman, it should be treated. And number three, those patients who has to undergo some kind of urologic intervention, it should be treated to prevent urosepsis. So in these conditions, asymptomatic bacteriuria should be treated. So coming to relapse and reinfection. So relapse of UTI happens within 3 weeks of antibiotic therapy. It occurs with the same infecting organism, and it is usually due to the either inadequate or due to inappropriate antibiotic therapy, or there is some sequestrated focus of infection either in the prostate in males or in the kidneys. So reinfection is defined as infection occurring more than 3 weeks after the treatment of previous episode. It can be with the same organism or the different organism, and most of the recurrent UTIs are due to reinfection, and it is caused by reintroduction of bacteria from the perineal flora. So recurrent UTI is defined as at least 2 episodes of uncomplicated cystitis within a 6-month period, or at least 3 episodes in a 12-month period. So we commonly see in our day-to-day practice that recurrent UTIs are very, very common among young healthy women in the absence of any anatomic functional abnormalities of the urogenital tract, and these females are genetically predisposed to the development of recurrent UTIs. While in men, recurrent UTIs are very uncommon, and if we find any male with recurrent UTIs, it is likely that he might be having some associated abnormalities of the urinary tract. So these are the table shows what are the risk factors that predispose women to the recurrent UTIs. So this is the treatment strategy for handling a patient with the recurrent UTIs. In females, there is a correlation of recurrent UTIs with the sexual intercourse. So in these patients, we advise a post-coital single dose prophylaxis, which can be given either with nitrofurantoin or a ceftriaxone. So those patients who experience less frequent episodes like 2 UTIs per year, they can be prescribed self-administered short course therapy like nitrofurantoin or a ceftriaxone for 3 days. While third category of patient who experiences more than 2 UTIs in a year, they should be given continuous low dose prophylaxis, and the drugs most commonly used are the nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone, because these 2 drugs are highly effective against all the uropathogens, and number 2, emergence of the resistance against these 2 drugs is very, very low. So norfloxacin can also be used, but it should preferably be avoided because of the risk of development of resistance. The duration of prophylaxis is 6 months, but patients frequently develop again UTI once the prophylaxis is stopped, and sometimes prophylaxis has to be extended for several years. So there are some adjuvant measures other than the antibiotics that can help to prevent the recurrent UTIs. We should advise adequate fluid intake and regular voiding, because it helps in flushing the bacteria out of the bladder. In those patients who have a correlation with the sexual intercourse, they should immediately void after the sexual intercourse. And those females who have who are using spermicides, they should use alternate methods of contraception, because these spermicides, they tend to alter the normal vaginal flora. And in postmenopausal women, replacement with the topical estrogen creams, they have been shown to reduce the episode of recurrent UTIs. So we have heard a lot of hype about the use of cranberry juice. It's also available in the form of tablets and capsules. The active ingredient are the proanthocyanidins, and the mechanism that has been proposed is that it causes acidification of urine and inhibits the bacterial proliferation. And number 2, it reduces the adhesion of the uropathogenic bacteria to the uroepithelial cells. But randomized controlled trials, they have failed to show any significant benefit on reduction of recurrence of UTIs. So this cranberry juice, tablets, capsules, they are practically ineffective in causing any reduction in the recurrence of UTIs. So now a few words about UTI in pregnancy. Asymptomatic bacteriuria is very common, and if left untreated, it may lead to development of pyelonephritis. So pyelonephritis, if it happens in pregnancy, it is associated with significant fetal morbidity in terms of low birth weight. So all pregnant patients, they should be screened for bacteriuria at their first antenatal visit, and if asymptomatic bacteriuria is found, it should be treated. So these are the drugs which are considered safe in pregnancy. We can use nitrofurantoin, we can use penicillins like amoxicillin, we can use cephalosporins like cefpodoxime and cefixime, we can use ceftriaxone. The points to be noted are nitrofurantoin and ceftriaxone should not be used in first and last trimester of pregnancy. Both of these drugs are safe in mid trimester of pregnancy, while penicillins and cephalosporins are safe throughout the pregnancy. And treatment is given for 5 to 7 days. So acute pyelonephritis, if it is a complicated acute pyelonephritis, it should be referred to the specialist for management. Uncomplicated pyelonephritis can be treated on OPD basis. Urine culture should always be stent before starting the antibiotic therapy. And patient of uncomplicated pyelonephritis should respond within a period of 48 to 72 hours. And if the patient is not responding within this period, then it is an indication to do the further imaging, maybe ultrasound or CT scan of the kidneys to rule out any obstruction or any other complicating factors. And duration of therapy will be 7 to 10 days if we are using quinolones and 14 days if we are using cephalosporins. So few words about the ferropenem. None of the guidelines about management of UTIs mention ferropenem. So this drug was made available more than a decade ago, and since then there is a rampant use, at least in the Asian subcontinent. It is not US FDA approved for any of the indications so far. So it is a broad spectrum orally active carbapenem, which is active against gram positive, gram negative bacteria, both aerobic and anaerobic, but it is not effective against methicillin resistant staph, vancomycin resistant enterococcus and pseudomonas. It is not US FDA approved, but off label use is very, very common. So I would like to say that we should restrict the use of ferropenem in uncomplicated lower UTIs when we have a simpler drugs to manage these UTIs, because ferropenem use can lead to development of cross resistance to other classes of carbapenems like imipenem, meropenem, doripenem, and carbapenems are the only higher antibiotics that are currently available for the management of serious infections. So ferropenem should not be used for the management of uncomplicated lower UTIs. We can consider it like switching the patients from IV to oral therapy in pyelonephritis and limit its use as far as possible. So I would conclude my presentation with key points that UTIs are the most common bacterial infections. So whenever we see a patient of UTI, try to identify if it is upper versus lower, if it is complicated or uncomplicated. So uncomplicated can be simply diagnosed with symptoms and urine microscopy. Urine culture is not necessary. Differentiate UTI from other causes of urethritis and vaginitis with careful history, because these conditions require a different type of therapy. Always treat with a short course of simple antibiotics like nitrofurantoin, ceftriaxone, and if this patient is not tolerating these drugs, you may use fluoroquinolones. Do not screen for asymptomatic bacteriuria. Do not treat patients with asymptomatic bacteriuria, and refer cases of complicated UTIs to the specialists for management. So these are the drugs that are used for the pyelonephritis, and we are all aware of this. So thank you all for your kind attention.
Thank you so much, ma'am. In the next line we have Dr. Diljit Singh Tillon, MS ENT consultant, Tillon ENT Center, Bathinda. And the topic is recent advances in pediatric allergy.
Good afternoon, friends, and my chairpersons. I am thankful to the organizers of this prestigious conference to give me time for this presentation. The recent advances in pediatric allergic rhinitis. The common allergic disorders in children are atopic dermatitis, GI disturbances, allergic rhinitis, allergic asthma, urticaria, and angioedema. The clinical features of atopic eczema appear first, followed by development of asthma and allergic rhinitis. There is typical allergic march, which is a progression of seemingly unrelated diseases. In genetically predisposed children, the disease starts as atopic dermatitis, then progresses to allergic rhinitis, and ultimately to allergic asthma. In infancy, the allergic disorders start with food allergens, which gradually decreases, and between the age of 1 to 3 years, the aeroallergens start playing their role, and aeroallergy increases with time. The long-term consequences of allergic disorders are nearly 80% of children with allergic disorders go on to develop allergic rhinitis and asthma. Children with early and long-lasting food sensitization are 3 times more likely to develop allergic rhinitis and 5 times more likely to develop allergic asthma than the others. The allergic rhinitis is IgE-mediated disorder, which involves inflammation of mucous membranes of the nose, eyes, eustachian tubes, middle ear, sinuses, pharynx. The nose is invariably involved, and the other organs are affected in certain individuals. Allergic rhinitis is characterized by rhinorrhea, nasal blockade, post-nasal drip, itching, sneezing, and associated comorbid conditions, and which are IgE mediated. Pediatric asthma is the most common chronic disease of childhood and the leading cause of childhood morbidity from chronic diseases as measured by school absences, emergency department visits, and hospitalization. Asthma leads to recurrent episodes of wheezing, breathlessness, chest tightness, coughing. The clinical symptoms in children 5 years and younger are variable and non-specific. This is widespread, variable, and often reversible airflow limitation. These are the mediators of allergic disorders and allergic asthma. Mast cell degranulation is there, thereby releasing the various inflammatory mediators leading to hypermucous secretion, vasodilation, obstruction, the stimulation of the nerve endings leading on to coughing, sneezing, and bronchospasm and bronchial hyperresponsiveness. 77% of asthma begins in children less than 5 years. The atopic dermatitis is another IgE-mediated type 1 hypersensitivity disorder. It is usually associated with personal or family history of hay fever, asthma, allergic rhinitis, or sinusitis. The acute phase appears as itchy erythematous patches, plaques, papules that may develop into vesicular lesions or may continue as a less non-vesicular erythematous eruption. There is an intense itching. Some of the cases may progress to chronic eczema, which is characterized by lichenification, scaling, thickening of skin, dryness, etc., and hyperpigmentation. The health effects of allergic rhinitis are social inconvenience, sleep disturbances, learning difficulties, impaired maxilla growth, dental problems, infections, and comorbid conditions like conjunctivitis, asthma, rhinosinusitis, otitis media. There is a great impact on the national productivity, loss of work hours, and the allergic disorders are a great burden on the national health system of the country. The pathophysiology of allergic rhinitis, again, there is a release of mediators which are responsible for various phases of allergy, early phase, late phase, chronic phase. The mediators are histamine, tryptase, kinins, heparin. The mast cells quickly synthesize other mediators, including leukotrienes, prostaglandins, and these mediators are responsible for nasal congestion, sneezing, itching, redness, and other clinical features of allergic disorders. Over 4 to 8 hours, these mediators, through a complex interplay of events, lead to the recruitment of other inflammatory cells, such as neutrophils, eosinophils, lymphocytes, macrophages. This results in continued inflammation, termed the LAIS phase response. The late phase may persist for hours or days. The incidence of allergic rhinitis varies from place to place. About 40 million people in the United States are supposed to be suffering from various types of allergic disorders. The overall incidence varies between 5% to 25% of the patients. As such, allergic rhinitis is not a life-threatening condition, but has got great morbidity. Almost all races are affected by allergic rhinitis. In childhood, allergic rhinitis is more common in boys than in girls, but in adulthood, the incidence equals. Onset of allergic rhinitis is common in childhood, adolescence, and early adult years, with a mean age of onset 8 to 11 years. Diagnosis of allergic rhinitis includes careful history, symptoms, frequency, family history is very important, and various trigger factors. Physical examination of the nose, like nasal crease, mouth breathing, allergic salute, allergic shiners, and ultimately lab investigations, including allergy testing. These are various signs of allergic rhinitis. Ultimately, in refractory cases who do not respond to empirical therapy, allergy testing is done. Gold standard is skin prick test or in vitro testing, including RAST and ELISA testing. Untreated allergic rhinitis can lead to upper respiratory tract infections, otitis media, nasal polyposis, sinusitis, and asthma. The classification of allergic rhinitis is the area classification in which the rhinitis is classified as intermittent and persistent, which are again mild and moderate to severe. In mild, there is no lifestyle impairment, and moderate to severe when it affects abnormal sleep, impairment of daily activities, sports, leisure, and abnormal work at school, and troublesome symptoms. The management strategy of allergic rhinitis includes avoidance of allergens, immunotherapy, and drug treatment. Strict environmental control is necessary, as concerned is the house dust mite, bats, cockroaches, mold, pollens, pollutants, and irritants. The various allergen avoidance measures are pets, remove pets from bedrooms, or even better, from the entire home, vacuum, carpet cleaning, mattresses, and wash pets regularly. For the molds, ensure dry environment. Use ammonia to remove molds from bathrooms and other bed spaces. Eradicate cockroaches and appropriate gel type of non-volatile insecticides. Eliminate dampness, cracks in floors, ceiling. Cover food, wash surfaces, fabrics to remove allergens. For pollens, remain indoors with windows closed at peak hours. Wear sunglasses. Use air conditioning wherever possible. Install car pollen filters. Regarding house dust mites, which is the commonest cause of perennial allergy, wash beddings regularly at 60 degrees centigrade. Provide adequate ventilation to decrease humidity. Use mite proof pillow covers, mattresses. Use vacuum cleaner with HEPA filters. Dispose of feather beddings, remove excess carpets and curtains, pets and stuffed toys from the bedrooms. Allergy, early evaluation of food allergies in pediatric age group starting from the time of weaning. There has been a gathering of momentum over recent years towards early introduction of allergenic foods may be important for inducing food tolerance as evidenced by several studies since 2009 in children with a family history of atopy. The drug treatment includes antihistamines, leukotriene modifiers like montelukast, corticosteroids, inhaled corticosteroids, decongestants, and anticholinergic drugs. The different drugs affect different symptoms of allergic rhinitis. Some of the drugs are potent anti-inflammatory, some are effective in rhinorrhea or itching, and use of a particular drug depends upon patient's symptoms and signs. We have got local antihistamine sprays like Agilastin, Levocarbastin, Olopatadine. Oral antihistamines, first generation and second generation, like CPM, Promethazine, Trichloridine, Hydroxyzine, Azetadine, and newer agents like Cetirizine, Levocetirizine, Loratadine, Desloratadine. The second generation oral antihistamines have got less side effects. They do not cross blood-brain barrier, so less sedative, wide margin of safety, and quite effective in controlling rhinorrhea, nasal pruritus, sneezing, obstruction. The various nasal corticosteroid sprays which are available are beclomethasone dry, propionate, budesonide, cyclosonide, fluticasone propionate, mometasone, triamcinolone, acetonide. These are most potent anti-inflammatory agents, effective in treatment of all nasal symptoms, including obstruction, superior to antihistamines and antileukotrienes, first-line pharmacotherapy for persistent allergic rhinitis. The other management aspects include management of comorbid conditions, allergic conjunctivitis, asthma, sinusitis, environmental manipulations, allergen avoidance, pollution control, nutritional support, activities and sport. The benefits of allergy testing and allergen immunotherapy include these alter the natural history of the disease, improve symptom control, decrease need for medical therapy, long-term cost effectiveness, may improve or prevent asthma or other comorbid conditions, may prevent development of new allergies. Immunotherapy is strictly contraindicated below 2 years and is recommended preferably after the age of 5 years. The situations when allergy testing is warranted are patients who do not respond to medical treatment, patients in whom the diagnosis of AR is uncertain, patients in whom identification of specific allergen could affect the therapy decisions or aid in titration of therapy, patients in whom antihistamines and moderate dose intranasal steroids insufficiently control symptoms with an adequate trial of medications being 2 to 4 weeks in duration. Immunotherapy and allergy testing can be done by radioimmunoassay or ELISA testing, that is in vitro testing, and skin testing. The radioimmunoassay or RAST includes, RAST is not influenced by medication, not influenced by skin diseases, does not require expertise, quality control possible, but it's slightly expensive. But the main gold standard is the skin testing, that is the skin prick testing. this has got higher sensitivity, immediate results, but requires expertise and slightly cheaper. The contraindications to immunotherapy for children is inability to communicate clearly with parents and medical staff, unstable asthma, isolated cutaneous reactions to insect strength, isolated atopic dermatitis, beta blocker therapy. The future directions is the use of immunomodifiers, that is omalizumab, an anti-IgE drug, is currently under evaluation for treatment of allergic rhinitis in Europe. No Indian clinical trials are available. Drug is currently being used in severe persistent asthma above the age of 6 years and chronic urticaria above the age of 12 years. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. If there are any queries, you can ask, sir. Ask to sir.
Thank you. Anji, sir. Yeah. There is a role of gut bacteria in the development of modifying the immune status of child. There are not many papers regarding various pathogens, staph infections, Klebsiella infections, and role of lactobacillus and prebiotics. But regarding lactobacillus, this has been found to be beneficial, particularly lactobacillus rhamnosus, which improves the production of IgEs, the blocking antibodies, IgGs, and reducing the symptoms of allergic rhinitis, and particularly delays the progression of allergic march and development of allergic rhinitis and asthma. Yes.
So is it important that can we give therapeutic treatment also for both other? But most of the time it is multiple. Many antigens.
When we subject the patient to in vitro testing, then there are false positive results, and we have got a long list of various allergens. But when we subject the patient to skin prick testing, the number reduces. This is one thing. Two, the results of immunotherapy for multiple allergens are not very good. The results, we can order the immunotherapy only for 2-3 allergens, which are major allergens, like house dust mite and various food allergens at a time. So we have to select which are the offending allergens, which are the most important, and we select those allergens from the list and order for the immunotherapy. Food allergy is the possible the first allergen sensitization of an infant, which starts right from the birth, and its food allergy gradually increases up to 3 years and then declines. The various offending allergens which have been found in literature are the cow milk, the nuts, egg, fish. So this is very important in infancy, particularly when family history is positive. And then the history of atopic is there, then we have to consider the use of these allergens. Yes, the allergy starts from eczema, then progresses to allergic rhinitis and asthma.
Immunostimulants like pitidobart, imulina available in the market.
The immunostimulants are under evaluation. There are various bacterial products. Various bacterial products are there, particularly the staph plasma membrane or covering of the bacteria. Drugs have been developed, but these are under evaluation.
Sir, have you any experience of using this immunostimulants on reasonable number of patients?
Pardon?
Have you experience of using it on reasonable number of patients?
Or how many you have?
How many patients you have used this immunostimulants?
No, I don't have any experience.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. The next we have Dr. Manpreet Singh Saluja, vascular surgeon, Delhi Heart Institute and Multispecialist Hospital, Bathinda. And the topic is CABG, past, present and future. Sir, please.
Good evening, seniors and colleagues. So I am working as a cardiothoracic surgeon at Delhi Heart Institute, Bathinda. I've just joined around 4 months back. So I'd be talking about coronary artery bypass surgery. And it will be more about the history and now what we are doing and the future of the coronary artery bypass surgery. So coronary artery disease is a major cause of cardiovascular death worldwide, as we all know. Cardiovascular disease is the leading global cause of death, accounting for more than 17.6 million deaths per year in 2016, a number that is expected to grow for more than 23.6 million by 2030. As by a 2014 study, coronary artery disease is rampant in Indians and its prevalence is several folds higher than the industrialized nations. The Registrar General of India reported that coronary artery disease led to 17% of total deaths and 26% of adult deaths in 2001-2003, which increased to 23% of total and 32% of adult deaths in 2010-13. The current burden of coronary artery disease in India is more than 32 million patients. And epidemiological studies show a sizable burden of coronary artery disease in rural, that is 3-5%, and urban 7-10% of populations. In India, studies have reported increasing coronary artery disease prevalence over the last 60 years, from 1% to 9-10% in urban population, and less than 1% to 4-6% in rural populations. So this is an impact of disease in coronary artery disease in India. So with this, our numbers of stenting and CABGs are increasing. So I'd like to talk about CABG first. The CABG is the most commonly performed cardiac surgery procedure worldwide. Annual volumes of approximately 2 lakh isolated cases in the US and an average incidence of 62 per 1 lakh inhabitants in Western Europe countries are seen. In mid 90s, about 10,000 CABG surgeries were performed in India. Now the number has increased to 1 to 1.5 lakhs per year as per the industry sources. So the journey of CABG has been embraced by many of the pioneers of cardiac surgery, with both their successes and failures. So I'd like to talk something about the history, historical part first, then we'll touch the what we are doing nowadays. So the history of cardiac surgery. It is defined as an open heart surgery in which a section of blood vessel is grafted from aorta to the coronary artery to bypass the blocked section of the coronary artery and to improve the blood supply of the heart. The pathophysiology of coronary artery disease was first established by Adam Hammer in 1876. That was way back around 150 years back. He postulated that angina, that is the imbalance of coronary perfusion supply and demand, was caused by interruption of coronary blood supply, and that MI, that is a common language heart attack, occurred after the occlusion of at least one coronary artery. So the first, I'll talk about the first era, that was 1960s where the CABG started. The development of coronary surgery can be tracked back more than 100 years back. Alexis Carrel, he first described the concept of operating on coronary circulation in 1910, and where he successfully performed the intrathoracic aortic and cardiac anastomosis in dogs. Then in 1935, Claude Beck was the first surgeon who placed muscle pedicles, omentum and pericardial fat inside the pericardium in order to increase the myocardial blood supply. Then Arthur Winneberg in 1946, he implanted the first left internal thoracic artery, that is the artery of thoracic chest wall, into the front wall of left ventricle. So here it started the concept of coronary artery surgery, that is called the Winneberg procedure, that led to symptomatic improvement in angina by developing the collaterals. The underlying method of improvement was development of collateral circulation of the left anterior descending artery. However, with the advent of direct coronary anastomosis of left internal thoracic artery to the LED, the Winneberg procedure was abandoned. So until this point in 1946, there was no coronary angiography. The main obstacle was we cannot able to picture the coronary arteries. So the coronary angiography came into being in 1958. where Mason Stones inadvertently injected the dye contrast into right coronary artery of a young man with rheumatic heart disease at the Cleveland Clinic. He subsequently followed this technique with first intentional selective coronary angiogram, which led to the birth of coronary angiography. So from there, it started the coronary angiography, and then bypasses and stenting started. So the second era was from 1960 to 1990s. This was where the different types of grafts originated. The first successful CABG surgery was performed by Robert Goetz in New York. On May 2nd, 1960, he anastomosed the right internal thoracic artery, that is the artery of right side of chest, into the right coronary artery of a New York taxi driver using a device with tantalum rings. Then he showed it by angiogram on post-op day 14, where the graft was patent. But the patient eventually died after 13 months, but still the graft was patent. The first successful hand-sewn anastomosis, that anastomosis done by Goetz was by a tantalum ring, stapler type of thing. Now, the hand-sewn anastomosis was done by Russian surgeon Vasily Koleslov. He sutured the right internal thoracic artery into right coronary artery in 1964. So then in 1968, George Green from St. Luke's Hospital, New York, he performed the first left internal thoracic artery to left anterior descending coronary artery, that is the main artery of the heart, which was become the absolute gold standard of coronary artery bypass surgery. So in 46 it started, then finally in 1968 the gold standard was established, left internal thoracic artery to LED artery, and CABG surgery that is known today is born in 1968. So experimental with experimentation continued, and then the different grafts came out. Then the saphenous vein grafts originated. The saphenous vein grafts were first used by René Favillaro. He was an Argentinian surgeon at Cleveland Clinic. In 1968, Favillaro used this graft in 150 patients. And that was set an important landmark with the birth of modern coronary artery surgery. In the early days of saphenous vein graft, it was recognized that this conduit was prone to failure because of a few things. Because of intimal hyperplasia and premature atherosclerosis that developed in the veins. So vein grafts are still considered inferior to arterial grafts. So definitive clinical evidence of internal thoracic artery, it was previously used, but clinical evidence came in mid-90s by Floyd Loop. He reported 10-year outcomes with internal thoracic artery, that is the artery of the left side chest, versus the total vein grafting. They showed that the use of thoracic artery, that is the arterial graft, was associated with improved survival, less risk of mitral infarction, less hospitalization, and less chances of repeat revascularizations. The physiological basis of superiority to saphenous vein graft was, these arterial grafts have a resistance to development of atherosclerosis, and they produce nitrous oxide, which leads to vasodilation, so they are more patent. Alan Carpentier, he recognized the superiority of mammary arteries over vein grafts may be extended to other arteries. So he used the radial artery graft in 1971. So this graft was failure because due to endothelial injury and mechanical dilatation, and the techniques of early RA harvest were not very good. So the revival of radial artery conduit came into being in 1992 because we are using new medicines to dilate the graft. That was done by Christopher Eckar. Then the concept of arterial revascularization is a result of benefit observed by single artery grafting compared to pure venous grafting. So logically, many groups then proposed, why not use the two thoracic arteries? So now we are using two thoracic arteries, right internal thoracic artery and left internal thoracic artery. That is a bilateral internal thoracic artery that came into being in 1990s. This was felt to be superior to single internal thoracic artery grafting. So despite this scientific evidence, the utilization of bilateral thoracic artery is still low. There are numerous factors, because there is an increased time and cost for bilateral thoracic artery grafting, while there is an increased risk of deep sternal wound infection. We do the surgery by cutting through the sternum. So if we take out bilateral arteries, there is chances of sternal wound infections there. So evidence supporting the utilization of both the internal thoracic arteries and radial arteries have evolved into relatively recent push for total arterial grafting. So nowadays we are going for total artery grafting rather than artery plus vein grafting. So total artery grafting is achievable in one third of isolated CABG patients with long-term survival that is superior to non-total artery grafting patients at 10 years. Now the third era, that's development of nowadays, we are moving towards the more and more small incisions and hybrid revascularization. So minimal invasive coronary artery surgery has developed on the foundation of thoracotomy. We don't use a full sternotomy approach, we go by thoracotomy approach. I'll show you in the next few pictures. The first minimal invasive direct coronary artery bypass grafting, that is called mid-cab. It emerged in 90s with an anterior mini thoracotomy. Rather than full sternotomy, it was done by a thoracotomy approach. The first set of 155 patients with isolated lesions to LAD was reported by Califiori in Italy. Then came the totally endoscopic grafting. Then we do by the ports. That also I'll show you in the next few slides. That was done by Dieter Lolumet in France in 1998. And then slowly we have been moving towards the robotic mid-cab, robotic surgery. And the total endoscopic anastomosis is performed by closed chest with ports, long instruments. And now further we are moving towards distal anastomotic device. We are using, instead of hand sewing, we have started using the staplers. It is still in an initial phase, but we have started using these staplers. And conduit harvesting, that is the vein harvesting and the thoracic artery harvesting, we are moving towards endoscopic harvesting. Rather than opening the whole leg and opening the chest, we are going towards endoscopic harvesting. So what are the fundamental basis of CABG is to re-establish the blood supply to the myocardium. So there are several different approaches we can go. First factor that was considered is the utilization of cardiopulmonary bypass or off pump, that is beating heart surgery. So most of the surgeries nowadays we are performing on beating heart. So early most cardiac surgeons, they were started beating heart, but then they shifted to bypass on pump still heart. Now again the interest on off pump bypass surgery have resurged in 1990s. The benefits of off pump or that beating heart are lower end organ damage, lower chances of renal failure, lower chances of cerebral vascular accidents, fewer cognitive deficits, less psychomotor defects, less need of blood transfusion, and reduced systemic inflammation. So minimal invasive robotic surgeries have also been developed. Minimally invasive surgery don't use the bypass machine, we do it on beating heart surgery. What are the benefits of minimal invasive surgery? Reduce operative time, patient is mobilized early, and reduce need for blood transfusion, and less ICU stay, and we are saving about 40% on the conventional CABG, that is on the heart lung machine. However, the total number of bypassable vessels is still less in minimal invasive surgery. We cannot do the total bypass, few arteries can be bypassed. For the conduits, we are using multiple grafts. In 2011 American Heart Association guidelines, they have advocated the use of arterial grafts more and more for the anastomosis of LAD grafting. So left internal thoracic artery, that's the artery of left side of chest, is considered the first choice. And why? Because internal thoracic arteries have a patency rate of 10-year patency more than 90%, because less than 4% of them developed atherosclerosis. Compared to vein grafting, vein grafts have a patency rate of 50 to 60% of 10-year, and half of them have developed the atherosclerosis. Other arterial grafts, as I have told, radial artery grafting is being done. Other grafts also were done, gastroepiploic artery, inferior epigastric artery, but they are not used nowadays. So mainly internal thoracic arteries and radial arteries are mostly used. Radial artery graft potency is best when it is used on left side of heart because of high grade stenosis, and less on the right side of heart. So these are the arterial conduits. This is the mammary artery, both right side and left side mammary arteries. This was originated by the work of Dr. Winneberg in 46. This is how we do the artery grafting. We open the sternotomy, then lift the sternum up, take out the artery from the right or left side, then graft it to the heart. And radial artery also we can take out from the mostly from the left hand of the patient. So this is the vein grafting. Vein harvesting we can use by the open method or by this open method and endoscopic method also. So these are different incisions. First we started using the full sternotomy with hemi, then came the hemisternotomy, then came the thoracotomy and minimal invasive bypass. So this is the conventional CABG done by full sternotomy, and on bypass and using the heart-lung machine with on still heart. But nowadays, less number of people are using this. This is a grafting of venous grafting and arterial grafting. This is the final picture of the CABG. So CABG surgery, how it evolved, earlier it was used on pump with sternotomy, then off pump without with sternotomy, then came the small incisions, then came small incision off pump. Now we are moving towards hybrid and robotic surgery. So this is a total endoscopic CABG. We are using only three ports and then bypassing the vessels. But the problem is we can use